I would like to welcome you to this online worship service at Trinity Lutheran Church in Bellingham, Washington. We have a wonderful God who in his love sent his Son, Jesus Christ, so that you and I may receive mercy, that you and I may be restored. In light of this, I invite you to join with me as we lift up our voice in praise to our Creator and our Savior.
God of glory, on your people pour your power. Crown your ancient church's glory, bring its blood to glorious flower. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage, for the facing of this hour, for the facing of this hour. Lo, the hosts of evil round us, sword the Christ assail your ways. From the fears that long have bound us, free our hearts to faith and praise. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage, for the living of these days, for the living of these days. Children's wearing madness, and our pride to your control. Shame our want of selfish gladness, rich in things and poor in soul. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage, let us remit your youth's gold.
We make our beginning today in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his own Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of the word, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart, in the company of the upright, in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of splendor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever. He has shown his people the power of his works in giving them the inheritance of the nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever, to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of all wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. Worthy is Christ, the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. Power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and blessing and glory.
Be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you show mercy to your people in their troubles. Grant us always to recognize your goodness, give thanks for your compassion, and praise your holy name. We ask this through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord. Amen.
Well, good morning. Thank you for joining us here on the live stream this morning. And kids, if you're around, make sure you're paying attention. We're going to have the children's message. So, kids, if you would fold your hands, bow your heads, we're going to say good morning to Jesus. And we could say it all together. Good morning, Jesus.
Good morning, Jesus.
and Jesus is with us. So, I have a question for you. Have you ever played Follow the Leader? I'm sure you've played that game many times, whether at school, on the playground, playing it with friends. I always used to enjoy that game because when you're the leader, you have all these people coming around and following what you're doing, whether it's walking around, touching your head, touching your elbow, touching your nose. You would follow the leader. So, you know, there are many leaders that we might see in our lives every day. Maybe you play a sport and you have a coach that leads you as you guys are practicing, playing games, and they're there to, I don't know, maybe draw up some plays and give you the different rules, and they teach you on how to play the game. And they can be a really great leader for you. Another person you might see every day at school is a teacher. A teacher can be a great leader as they are teaching you all the different things that you're supposed to learn in school and teaching you all the good things, the bad things that you shouldn't do while you're sitting in class. But teachers are great people that are leaders, and we can follow them as we're going every day in school. Well, another person or people that you might see as leaders every day are your parents or your grandparents, your aunts and uncles. They're here to guide you on the right path and lead you to where you're supposed to go. And again, they might teach you or tell you some things, oh, maybe let's stay away from that path. One of my favorite leaders that I like to think about is Jesus. Jesus told his disciples back in the New Testament to follow him, follow what he said, and follow all the different places that he went to. So we have all of these leaders in our lives. There are some good ones, sometimes there might be some bad ones, but we can know that Jesus is one of the best leaders, and he asks us to follow him. And we can show our love to God by following Jesus. So if you want to fold your hands, bow your heads, and we will pray to God. And if you want to repeat after me, that would be great. Dear Jesus, thank you for being our leader, for being our leader. Thank you for all the leaders, you give to us. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you, guys. The New Testament lesson comes from the 8th chapter of Romans. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justified. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is also at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to the 17th chapter of St. Luke. Glory be to you, O Lord. Now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourselves to the priest." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to the God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ.
Let us now confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Beautiful Savior, King.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God, our Heavenly Father, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We've all experienced it. To be sure, some have experienced it more times, more severe, and for others, maybe it has lasted longer. What is it? Being injured or being sick. I have to say that as I look over my life, I have to say, I haven't had it all that bad. That doesn't mean nothing has happened to me. When I was young, I had to be isolated because I caught chickenpox and the mumps. When I was in elementary school, I had to walk with crutches for about a month. I have, along with you, probably had some severe colds, which have left me feeling miserable for a week or two. I played basketball, and as I played basketball, there were times I sprained my ankle so bad I could barely walk, and I was unable to play ball for a couple of weeks. We've all experienced things which have put us out of commission for a while. There are also times when we have needed more help when we've become injured or become sick. For me, this happened in March of 2021 when I fell and broke my wrist. Visiting with the doctor after that happened, the doctor said I basically had two options. One was to go in for surgery, and the other was to just set my hand. But if I set my hand, it wouldn't heal completely, and I would have limited movement in my wrist. Those were the options, surgery or no surgery. And for me, the option was clear. I wanted to have surgery. I wanted to be able to have my wrist restored so I could move it like it was before. Doctors help with broken bones. They also help with other life-threatening circumstances. I think of those who have gone or are now going through cancer, like my wife, or those battling heart disease, a serious car accident, or other life-threatening conditions. When serious injury strikes, it impacts not just the one who is suffering, but also the family. Unfortunately, ever since the fall of humankind, sickness, injury, and disease has plagued humanity. And those who have been threatened by these things have sought relief, sought healings, at times by going to doctors. Now, seeking relief is something that we actually see in the gospel lesson for today. The lesson begins by Jesus going to Jerusalem. That's what the writer mentions. Luke mentions going to Jerusalem for a very specific reason. It's to remind you and me that Jesus is going there to die. And while he is on his way to his death, Christ is met by people who were considered at that time to already have one foot in the grave. He was met by 10 lepers. In New Testament times, the term leprosy was used to cover a wide range of skin diseases. Now, we do not exactly know what type of skin diseases these lepers had and how much they suffered physically from it. Whatever the severity, we have written documents by rabbis around New Testament times saying that curing leprosy was as difficult and as unlikely as raising someone from the dead. But the physical trouble was only part of their problem. For with leprosy came social alienation. They had to live apart from the community. They were ostracized. They were avoided. They were forced to stay away from those that they loved. We actually see this in the gospel lesson for today. We read, as Jesus was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance. Yes, they couldn't get close to Jesus or anyone else. And they called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." Before I continue with this text, I think it is important to stop here and talk about loneliness and social alienation. It's not just something that has happened in the past. Researcher David Kinnaman has done some extensive research on why people leave the church. And in some of his studies, he's also identified some of the major challenges that the church faces as it seeks to reach out to people today. And one is social alienation. Even though it may seem easier for us by just a touch on our cell phones or smartphones to connect to anyone around the world, many people today are experiencing isolation. Although this may not apply to you, Kinnaman points also to the disillusion of the family, withdrawal from flesh and blood community to all things digital, and a lack of trust in traditional institutions as also things which contribute to people feeling lonely, isolated, and alienated from others. Maybe this is something that you have seen in other people as they struggle, or maybe it's something that you are struggling with today. It is definitely something that the 10 lepers dealt with, but that all changed with Jesus. Let us continue to look at the gospel lesson so that actually we may find encouragement. The leper stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." Or in the Greek, it's "your faith has saved you." As we look at this text, we are again reminded that the lepers ask for mercy, for hands-on help from Jesus. But what they received is so much more. In our world today, oftentimes mercy is just associated with pity for someone who has it in a bad way. But in this Bible passage, mercy is found with Jesus, and mercy includes action. Jesus said, "Go, show yourselves to the priests." And on their way, they were healed. To bring more clarity to this passage, it is good to remember that in Old Testament and New Testament times, the priests served also like those working at a medical clinic. The priests were the ones who determined whether someone had leprosy or not, and they were also the ones who were able to declare if someone had been cured of leprosy. And when someone had been cured, that was followed up by bringing a thank offering to God. What is interesting is that when the lepers discovered that they were healed, only the Samaritan returned to Jesus. He fell at Jesus' feet and he thanked him. And Jesus' response is critical to understanding this text. It's not that the other 9 did not give thanks. To be sure, if you are cured of leprosy in New Testament times, you would be thankful. Their health was restored. They would be able to again go back to their families. But the 9 were wrong in not seeing Jesus as the personal embodiment of God working to restore all things to how they should be. The Samaritan did thank Jesus, which means that he thanked God personally, because, as you know, Jesus is true God, the true Son of God. And by this restoration, by Jesus, it's important to see that he not only brought about physical healing, but he brought about also restoration into the community, but also, as we look at the Samaritan, he restored his relationship with his Creator. In many ways, this text gives us a glimpse, a preview of God's plan in Christ to restore his broken creation to its physical and social perfection. Just as Jesus restored the lepers, Christ will restore us to full and perfect health when he comes again. And just as important, we will no longer experience loneliness, alienation. We will no longer experience being separated from those who we love who have died in the faith, because they're going to be with us in heaven. We will be welcomed into God's family. We will never, ever feel alone, and it will be glorious. And Jesus' resurrection from the dead is the foundation for our confession that one day we are going to be completely restored, physically, emotionally, and socially. Yes, in this life, we're going to experience injuries. We're going to experience sickness. We're going to feel like we're pushed away from others. But in the future, that will not be the case. This is something that we are to hold on to as our bodies are injured, stricken with disease. It's something that we are to hold on to as we face death or experience the pain of losing someone to death. Remember that going to Jesus, we find mercy and help. Going to Jesus, we are reminded that we have a future. And in Jesus, we also find a place where we will be welcomed and loved and never feel alone again. Today in our service, we are also recognizing the LWML. This is an organization committed to getting that message out to the world that there is mercy and grace in Jesus. That in Jesus, there's not only forgiveness of sins, but there is belonging. That in him, we are able to become part of God's family. The great news that we have is that as we go to Jesus, we have mercy. We have life. We have fullness of life. This is something worth celebrating. This is something worth being thankful for. This is something worth sharing with others. And so I encourage you on this day to, of course, be grateful for what God has done for you in Jesus Christ, but also, in what ways you can, share it with others. Amen. Once again, I would like to thank you for watching this service. And we encourage you, if you have a concern, or if we could be of help, contact the church office. At this time, we continue with our prayers. Dear Lord, give us steadfast love and heartfelt gratitude for every good gift that comes from you. Tune our hearts to sing your praise. Make us eager to witness your mercy to others through our words, actions, and offerings. We pray for our congregation, its people, its ministries, and its mission. In all things, shape us into vessels of your generosity and holiness, so that many people may receive life and salvation. We pray for our world, broken by evil and bruised by violence. Guide all who are entrusted with authority in government, commerce, education, and whatever else affects your people. On this day, we pray for the mission of the LWML in this congregation and throughout the world, that each person involved would see opportunities to be salt and light to their neighbors and through various opportunities for mission. Lord Jesus, your compassion moved you to heal 10 lepers. According to your will, give healing to all those affected by disease, despair, or the shadow of death. In our prayers for today, we remember Helen, Barb, Pat, and Alice, along with Ryan, Henry, Barb, Sally, and Marilyn. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.